The UK leaving the EU would be a nail in the coffin for the EU.
So I think if the UK leaves EU, it might generate another fallout in other countries.
I think making demands and threatening to leave is school ground behavior.
Full commitment is better than cherry picking. Cherry picking can be only a short-term strategy.
I think the UK will lose the status of economic center in Europe, especially finance and banking section.
An underlying challenge of the European Union is what reforms have to be made so that citizens feel more attached to the European institutions.
It's my great pleasure to welcome you to this debate today, Brexit, subtitled Europe's Fateful Moment. And I'd like to introduce two members of the panel. I think I've been introduced before. Mark Beaulieu is on my extreme left. He's chairman of one of the most powerful committees in the whole of the United Kingdom, namely the Policy and Resources Committee of the City of London. He's also chairman of the Housing and Finance Institute, and he's been on the advisory board of PricewaterhouseCoopers. He's had a lifetime's experience with the city and with international trade organizations. On my immediate left is, I think, Mark, you're an Englishman.
From Jersey. But not English.
Not English, you see.
Yeah.
Can I say, in that case, he's from Jersey, the Channel Islands, he is Scottish and I'm Welsh. Yeah. So...
You have a mix.
So we let me introduce the Scotsman, and then I'll tell you something. The Englishman didn't turn up, but that's because he's ill, not because he didn't want to. On my immediate left is Gary Gillespie. Gary is the chief economic advisor to the Scottish Government. It's a very influential position, as the implications of devolution in terms of taxation and the areas of the breadth of control which the government has in Scotland over economic policy is increasing. Before he was appointed as chief executive, he was very involved in the University of Strathclyde and is now an honorary professor as well at Glasgow Caledonian. There was to be a member of the fourth member of this panel, Tim Montgomery, who's a personal friend of mine, columnist with the Times, feels passionately in favor of Brexit, and in fact resigned from the Conservative Party in February of this year because of statements by David Cameron. Unfortunately, Tim has gone down with a very nasty bug and cannot be here. So I'm wearing two hats. I'm on the one hand chairing the panel, and on the other hand, I shall make a statement in support of Brexit. What we'd like to do, given the turnout for this, which I think is fantastic, because it is such a big issue, what I'd like to do is to ask each of us to take, say, 10 minutes stating the case, and then let's have half an hour of questions and answers and discussion. So, Mark, it's over to you.
Well, thank you very much, Chairman. It's great having a chairman already declaring what side he's on. No, Okay, so I'm a typical Londoner. I wasn't born in England. I come from little Channel Island of Jersey, and I can trace my ancestry back to a lot of French peasants. But London is great simply because it is a mixture of amazing nationalities. I think, Chairman, you mentioned the vote coming up. In my view, this is the most important vote in Europe for many, many years, far more important than a general election vote. And you showed some nice videos of young people. The great news is that the young people in Britain are overwhelmingly in favour of Britain remaining in the European Union. The bad news is that they're overwhelmingly not likely to vote, because they are either lazy, or very lazy, or think it doesn't matter, or haven't bothered to register, So I hear a few boos, please go out and vote. The City of London view, and we are the local authority, very powerful, as the chairman said, thank you. Not quite that powerful, but one of the things we do is represent the financial services business in the UK, and we don't care what nationality it is, by the way, as long as it's in Britain. And those businesses tell us Britain needs to be in the European Union. And all the analysis we've seen tells us the same, whether it's Christine Lagarde today, the Bank of England yesterday, PwC, who've done some work for the CBI, independent analyses, even Capital Economics, whose chief executive favours Britain leaving, has said it would be quite damaging to the financial services business. And why is this? Well, it's about the single market. And we've discovered that not many people really understand what the single market is, which perhaps is not surprising. A business that's authorised and regulated in the United Kingdom, or indeed any European Union country, can operate throughout the whole of the European Union without further authorisation. Can do so using what we call the passport. And also, as far as we're concerned in Britain, anybody from the European Union can work in Britain. Now, Britain happens to specialise in financial services. Other countries specialise in other things. We're very good at it. We export huge amounts and we import virtually none. Few figures here. There are 100,000 people working in investment banking in Europe. About 90,000 of them are working in Britain. Now, it's not just the fact that that's what businesses want. We've looked long and hard at the regulation. The government conducted a great balance of competences study a few years ago. It's very thick. Not many people have read it. But the view of business was that actually the balance between what Europe does and what Britain and other countries do is about right. And on financial services, there was certainly no appetite to repatriate regulation. And on financial services in particular, the notion that by not being in the European Union, we would have lighter touch financial regulation, nobody believes that. And indeed, one reason our Prime Minister vetoed a 2011 treaty was to be able to impose stronger capital controls on the banking system than the European Union wanted. So for all of these reasons, the financial services industry, not unanimously, but a very big majority, want Britain to remain in the European Union. And our views aren't vastly different from many other industries. Last week, I read what Hitachi had to say, a Japanese company with a big business in the United Kingdom, making it clear they're in Britain because they love everything about Britain, the talent, the weather, it's better than Switzerland, but also access to the single European market. The pharmaceutical industry collectively said the same last week. We also need to look at the counterfactual. I fully accept that the European Union is not perfect. I very nearly became a Eurocrat 40-odd years ago, and much of my work has been involved with the European Union. Yes, of course, it's stupid to have the European Parliament in Strasbourg while everything else is in Brussels. And yes, there's a great deal of waste. National governments can produce this on their own at times without the help of the European Union. And that's part of the bad side of what Europe has done. The euro has not been a stunning success. It was not properly designed. Europe's gone too far in many other directions. But you don't say, just because I don't like the way my partner eats chips, that I'm going to divorce her. You know, you do look at the good things as well. And on balance, well, perhaps you might. I don't know. I mean, we always thought people in Switzerland were a bit odd, but never mind. So what's the counterfactual? Now, until recently, we didn't have one. The people who wanted Britain to be out had every sort of argument, like we would no longer be tethered to a corpse. We would be free to do trade deals with America. And how dare President Obama say we can't? And we could do trade deals with our great friends in Australia. Remember them, our former cousins? Well, they've said not quite the same, but not far off. But now we know what the Leave campaign want. They want Britain outside the single market, meaning no free movement of labour, and the immigration issue is quite important. And for us, that's pretty devastating in the city. I hosted an event for the French finance minister 2 days ago. I looked around the room and I had Deutsche Bank and BNP and an American investment bank. I had Frenchmen, German, Italians. That's what London is. That's what makes London so great. Last week, we elected as our mayor a Muslim son of a taxi driver, of a bus driver, with Pakistani origins. Nobody had any problems with that at all. London's a fantastic mixture of nationalities, and that's why our culture is so great. Our football is great because we have no English footballers. Yeah. And strange people are managers. We fired half the managers today, I think. All the Italians have been fired. They'll all be employed by another team next week. As long as their name ends in I and they worked in Italy once, they can seem to manage anybody. European Union. Sorry, yeah, without that. Indeed, one of the Eurosceptics said to me last week, he was from Leicester, and wasn't it brilliant that Leicester City had won the Football League and this was nothing to do with Europe? I said, without Europe, you wouldn't have Claudio Ranieri as your manager. And that finished his argument. That's got a bit remote from the subject, but seriously, and it is deadly serious, the view of business generally in Britain, not just financial services, is that Britain needs to be in the European Union. The view of other countries is precisely the same. We bring a lot to the party. We need to bring much more. We need to be less shouting from the sidelines about what's wrong and getting it right from the beginning. Very clear message from the City of London. Britain needs to be in the European Union and more engaged than it's been in the past. Thank you.
Gary.
Okay, thank you very much. Sitting in the middle is ideal for me because my career job is a civil servant, and that implies that we are politically neutral, but not policy neutral. So the views I'll give today represent the views of the Scottish Government and Scottish Government ministers rather than me personally. So I'm slightly wearing two hats as well, Chairman, if I can say that. So firstly, I think to set out the perspective of the Scottish Government first and foremost, their overriding view, quite similar actually to the keynote address by the Prime Minister of Luxembourg, is that the EU, despite many of its imperfections, is actually a source for good in the world. And actually, over the last 40 years, Scottish society, individuals, businesses, communities have benefited enormously from social, cultural, and economic benefits. So that's the starting premise. It's slightly different context in Scotland relative to the UK, and I'll say a little bit more about that as I go on. So the kind of central proposition is the EU is good. It's good for small, open economies. They see much of the benefit in being able to pool sovereignty, to influence and deal with international type issues. Just some factoids in relation to Scotland. So we're a small, open economy, 5.3 million people. A GDP per capita broadly the same as the UK. We're in that northern part of Europe. Weather much like the last 2 days here. unless you come in June, that's our summer month. We have 173,000 EU citizens who study, live and work in Scotland. They make a valuable contribution, particularly in some key sectors, including healthcare. We have approximately 300,000 jobs supported directly through our trade with Europe. And of the 2,500 foreign-owned companies in Scotland, 1,000 of those originate from the EU. So very positive in terms of that type of context. Now, it's worth probably just reflecting where we are now at this time. It's 6 weeks today, we'll know the results. And I was looking at some of the polls yesterday, which suggests actually at the UK level, it's very close. It's almost 50-50. And the Remain campaign have a very narrow lead. In the Scottish context, the polls have been consistently in favour of staying in the EU. And there's as much as a 20 to 30 percentage point gap in favour of staying. So that's an interesting question, why the Scots are so pro the EU relative to the kind of more general view and within across the UK. And probably there's a number of reasons for that. One is this idea of the greater good of the EU, the social, cultural, and economic. The second thing is probably population growth and migration. There's probably a different view in Scotland. You only have to go back 12 years or more where we were predicting our population of 5.2 million to drop below 5 million. And that was arrested largely through the in-migration from the accession countries. So very positive impact in terms of that. Many parts of Scotland, if you know Scotland, we have a, a large rural community, 30% of the landmass of the UK, so the Highlands and Islands, if you go up towards Inverness, Skye, they've benefited largely from European Structural Funds programmes. We also benefited from EU research programmes also. So that's kind of a big positive case for it. And our ministers would also say that the social protection provides a minimum platform. Many of the social standards, the equality, have benefited workers and such in Scotland. But let me turn a little bit to the economics of it now, and I'll pick up on some of the points that Mark made. So in considering the economic case then, what is the counterfactual? What will happen if the UK leaves the Brexit? And over what time period will that occur? And then how do you assess the costs and benefits? So as Mark said yesterday, the Bank of England, in their Monetary Policy Committee report, suggested that the short term at least would lead to slower growth, higher inflation, potential sterling depreciation, and also a technical recession. So that's the short run. In the long run is really contingent on what option you get to and the cost of the transition. So if you think about the process and the different options, Article 50 of the EU treaty allows for a two-year period. So you have a two-year period to negotiate your exit. And in a sense, if no agreement is made over that period, your membership expires, unless you have an agreement to extend that process. So that's the first thing, the transition, how you would negotiate that. And then essentially, what is the option that our chairman will present for the Brexit that you would want to achieve? And in a sense, I'll refer to some work that the UK government treasury published around three different options. The first was that you have the Norway model, which is essentially the European Economic Area. The second is a bilateral model, similar to Swiss, Turkey, where you negotiate individual deals. And the third option, which is probably the option now out with the single market, which is referred to as the WTO model. So that's the three types of models. And what they did was they used a macroeconomic modelling process from the National Institute to simulate the impacts on two key economic variables, trade and investment, over a 15-year period. And essentially what the results suggest by simulating this type of shock is that the level of GDP in 15 years' time could be, on the Norway model, 4% lower, on the Swiss model around 6%, and in the out with the single market model over 7%. So that implies slower trend growth over that period. So to do the counterfactual properly, you've got to define your model, your end game. Think about whether the two-year transition period can get you there. What happens if you're out with that period? And then would you realise the benefits that you pertain to have, whether they be the UK's saving the contribution of the net contribution of about $7 billion a year? Is it control over migration? Is it greater flexibility in terms of the regulatory regime? So you've got to get there first. And as always, you start from where you start, which is within a fully integrated system. Mark gave some numbers about how important the EU is to the City of London. In the broader context of the UK, it supports about 3 million jobs, 2 million in services, 1 million in manufacturing. 42% of UK exports go to the EU. Approximately 8% of EU exports come into the UK. So that's the broad context for that. I'll finish now with just a couple of remarks about Scotland, if I may. So we had the Scottish referendum in 2014, and there's some discussion about the potential impact of any change in 6 weeks' time on that position. So the first thing I would say is that the Scottish referendum was a legal binding referendum which was agreed with the UK government. It was set out in a document called the Edinburgh Agreement. And is that actually, irrespective of the result, it was quite a positive discussion. 85% of people voted, and there was a real sense of purpose discussion about the type of Scotland people wanted. I don't think we've quite got that on the EU discussion yet, but anyway, that's the central point. As Mark mentioned also, the London mayor elections were last Thursday. In Scotland, we had the Scottish elections as well, and the same government essentially got close to a majority and will be the leading party. Now, the position today is that the Scottish government have not planned for a second referendum. They believe any future referendum lies with the sovereignty of the people, and it's not for them to defer. And the First Minister is also on record as saying that she wouldn't like independence to arise solely from a UK exit. So they're very much pro-Remain and pro-supporting the case for the whole of the UK to stay in that. But it's worth saying that if there was a vote to leave, it would cause political uncertainty and it would cause that whole question to be revisited again. Thank you.
Let me assure you that I will be an impartial chairman, but I do feel like a lawyer being handed a brief because the defendant is not able to be here. Can I just say that, to start with, the case for Brexit is not a racist case. It's not because of a sense of British superiority. And it certainly is not anti-Europe. But there is an increasing frustration with Brussels. And the failure, seemingly, of Brussels to go in a larger direction, a more inclusive direction than it has. And I would make the following points in the case for Brexit. The first is, let's be frank, the European Union is not working. The euro is a monetary union without a fiscal union, without a political union. You cannot have levels of unemployment of 5-6% in Germany and Austria, and levels of unemployment in Italy, Spain, and Greece in, you know, the upper teens in for youth unemployment, 20-30% and so on. That is not a sustainable monetary union. Secondly, the European Union is not able to control its borders. Any functional state has to be able to control its borders. The European Union, as a political entity, is a dysfunctional entity. And you see it most of all in Schengen. First of all, we have free movement of labor within Europe, but then we have the Schengen Agreement, where we have a borderless area. Now what do we have? We have five countries in Europe: Hungary, Greece, Macedonia, Bulgaria, and even Austria, putting up fences to keep out people from other European countries. You cannot say that Europe is working in a borderless way with that. I mean, the problem I would face, knowing a little about politics, is if you put these fences up and the people are behind putting the fences up, it's going to be quite difficult to take them down. And the third point, which I think the people who believe in Brexit have held for a long time, is the pace of integration that the European Commission has set in Brussels is so much faster than the pace of integration that the peoples of Europe had wanted. So what we have is a demographic deficit in Brussels, but at the same time, we have a bureaucratic surplus. And for those three reasons, I think the Brexit case would be what we have at present is not working. The second is that the more we see of the European Union project, it is fundamentally a political project. It was a political project in its inception at the end of the Second World War to bring Europe together. But the European coal and steel community, the European common market, is really part of a process to a full-scale political union. and the expression of acquis communautaire, ever closer union, suggests that it is a political project. I think in Britain, we've tried 70 times to put a proposal to do something we've been outvoted on every occasion. And as a political project, the European Union shows no appetite for changing its course. Given our political heritage in the United Kingdom, the longest surviving democracy, we believe not just in democracy, but we believe, like the Swiss, in self-government. And I have to say, I think it's a challenge for Brussels to say they believe in self-government. Thirdly, we come to the economic issues. And I should say, business has in the past strongly supported Britain joining the European exchange rate mechanism. It proved for Britain to be a disaster. Business was very much in favor of joining the euro. If Britain was in the euro, I think we would have had horrendous problems, not just for the UK, but also for the rest of the euro area. There's no question, my colleagues here are absolutely right in saying it, that there is a short-term cost of Brexit. About that, there is no doubt. But on the other hand, when you net out all the benefits from Brussels, we still have a deficit of something like 15 billion euros. So in other words, we would gain that much as a result of leaving. Secondly, to the extent there's excessive regulation, and certainly small businesses feel there are, we would be free of that. And thirdly, the European Union is not a free trade area. And the euro is not a free trade area. It's a customs union. Why do you form a customs union? Because you're a protectionist outfit. You form it to keep people, you've put fences up against trading with the rest of the world. And we would, you see it most clearly of all in, for example, African countries and Caribbean countries not being allowed to export products into Europe. We would benefit from that. I think that the positive case is that we believe in enterprise, we believe in a market economy, and we see Brussels as too much of a welfarist entity politically and too much concerned with regulation, where the balance of enterprise and regulation has gone too far in one direction. If you say, but as somebody who I'm putting the argument for Brexit, for the people of Brexit, what would they see as the downside? There's certainly a short-term economic cost. There's the problem of what would happen to Scotland. Would Scotland then vote for independence with a breakup of the European Union? That's something to be taken account. And finally, and I think most people who believe in Brexit would say, there is a moral issue, which is, what would be the impact on the rest of Europe? Would other countries want to leave Europe? If so, to what extent would that be destabilizing? And that's something that should be taken into account. But can I finish where I started? The case for Brexit is not a case about being anti-Europe, not European, and so on. It's a case for a more enterprising, free trade world and moving in that direction. That's the case as a lawyer, which I would make for that position. So, ladies and gentlemen, instead of us talking here among ourselves, I'm going to open it up to you, and you can put any question you want to any of us. This gentleman there already in the dark, his hand was up. If you could just say your name and then...
Yeah, thank you very much. My name is Geoffrey. I come from Belgium, but I am currently in the UK. So I'll make a quick point. So I feel like the debate has, or your points have been very much made on facts. Whereas, as we know, I very much feel that the vote on the 23rd of June will be on emotions. So my question is, why is it that it's not been possible since 1973 to some extent instigate the idea of the EU in the UK? I very much feel like the European identity is not there in the UK. So I walk sometimes across London, I don't see any EU flag. I walk through the streets of Rome, I do see some. So I guess my question is the failure of the case for staying in not far, has it not happened a long time ago? So if the UK leaves on the 23rd of June, isn't it, will it have failed on that day, or has it failed a long time ago? Thank you.
Let me turn to our star performer from the City of London. How would you answer that, Mark?
I would agree to some extent. Britain joined the European Union for a different reason from other countries. Brian is quite right. It was set up always as a political institution. That was the motive behind it, although some say we thought we were joining a common market 40-something years ago. And other countries, the more recent members that have joined, again, have joined for political reasons and very sound political reasons. I do recall the debate about joining. My degree was actually in European studies. I was around at the time. And the expression we had about Britain was, we are the sick man of Europe. And look at what these great people are doing in France, and Germany, and Italy, and we're missing out on it. So Britain has always been a bit semi-detached, in that in the past our history is about the Commonwealth, the countries we've had links with more than the European Union. We have not been invaded. We have not suffered as much as other countries from war. So we have been more semi-detached. The debate, interestingly, is very much a debate among the political classes. If you ask people to list what their concerns are over the last few years, Europe hardly gets on the list. You know, they don't talk about it in the pubs of Scunthorpe. And even now, actually, you go outside London and you'll still find people not talking about it. The big European events we're looking forward to are the Eurovision Song Contest this weekend.
Yeah.
Sad, but true. And the European football.
The Champions
League. Far more likely, which we won't do very well in, because, again, we don't have any English footballers. Mm. But never mind. But for most people, it just is not an issue. But we've had a couple of newspaper groups that have been strong, kept for years and years going on about the European Union issue. At one level, you're right. But, you know, you walk through the streets of Rome, you're not going to see quite as many Brits as we see Italians in the streets of London. You know, the languages I hear when I'm walking around the city is every European language imaginable. And the people we have running our top businesses are from every country. Today I think you've had a man from the Ivory Coast running Credit Suisse based in London. We have a Frenchman running a stock exchange. Our nationalized banks are run by a New Zealander and a Portuguese. Yes. That's what London is. So to that extent, in London and in the extent of our football, we're far more European than any other country. But I agree, there's still that attitude, we're different.
Yeah, just to pick up on the point about emotions and facts or whatever, and there was a lot of discussion of that around the Scottish referendum about whether people would vote with their heart or their head, and they end up as a combination of both. You need the facts. I think one difference from this debate is that the referendum in Scotland was discussed in all the pubs. Mm. You couldn't go to a pub without hearing a debate about whether we'd be better off or worse off. So it hasn't really captured the imagination of the populace yet. And I think part of that's to do with the media, part of that's to do with the interest groups, and in a sense, the case not being relevant enough. So there's something about within the UK thinking about their role within Europe, how they advocate that, how we view the European Parliament, and the types of stories that we report in our media. And a day in, day out, it tends to be more about the imperfections of Europe, the bureaucracy, the issues that can't be dealt with. So there is something in that.
I would just say two things in relation to that. We had a referendum in 1975 which I voted in, and I voted in favor of remaining in Europe. At that time, you know, the European Union was seen as the future. It was seen as a dynamic area. This is where growth would come from, innovation would come from. It's very interesting that David Cameron, in making the case to remain, it's sometimes called Project Fear, that he's never really made the case to say, or he's never made much of the case, that the future lies in the European Union. Mm. I mean, I think that's just a fact. The second thing is, I very much agree, and not that I know much, unlike Mark, about the pubs of Scunthorpe, but...
I don't either.
But can I say the one thing we do, which has... I remember in the House of Lords, I was on the Select Committee on Economic Affairs, and we did a review about 10 years ago of immigration. And since then, I would say, where people see the impact of the free movement of labor, but also the potential of a borderless agreement like Schengen, is in immigration. And I think that the sharp end of that is not, in a way, it's not immediately the EU, or whether you pro or for the EU, but it's really what's happening in your schools. Are there so many people coming in, even from, say, a country like Poland, in East Anglia, Norfolk, that your children are being held back in classes because the people don't start with English? Or what about the health service? Is the health service, or what about housing? And we've been running net migration of something like 300,000 a year for a long time. And that's really where I think the focus is. Okay. There's a gentleman, I think it's a gentleman, right, yes. Straight opposite me, with a lot of hair, and quite young. No, it wasn't you, sir, it was a man. That's right. And then we'll come to you.
Hi, my name's Mark, from Ireland, so I have a fairly good interest in what happens in this. But you were talking about the new mayor of London, and just talking about the old one, Boris Johnson, and how he split ranks to go against and go with the Leave vote. Do you think there's a problem with politicians on the Leave side merely leading that campaign as a means to gain power if Brexit were to go forward?
How dare you suggest that politicians do things to gain power?
Can I say, I personally wouldn't dream of commenting on that issue. But it does raise one really important issue. In a way, whatever the outcome of this referendum, I think we have, in a way, changed the whole atmosphere of debate in the UK. You know, five ministers in the government are opposing it. One of them, a senior cabinet minister, has resigned. It's going to be very hard, actually, for David Cameron and his MPs, something like over 100 Conservative members of Parliament, are in favour of Brexit. So he faces a huge challenge trying to get this together. And I think that the point to me, which your question highlights, is whatever the outcome, we're actually going to be in for a sort of turbulent period. Because and all the polls at present are suggesting, not all the polls, but 90% of them, are suggesting that Remain will win. But it's going to be, I think, a challenge. I don't know what others think.
Can I agree entirely with that? And I think the notion this will all be over on June the 23rd, no, it won't. And you have the prospect even of a close Remain, with the Scots and London, incidentally, voting very much to Remain, or even the other way. Yeah. You could get some politicians saying, it was a fix, we didn't believe it, we will campaign for the Conservative Party to go into the next election to take Britain out of the European Union. So it will remain to be seen what happens after June the 23rd. And we could be in for a period of substantial instability, as we are in some other European countries and some other big countries around the world as well.
Yeah. And also, if I can just add one thing to that, then come back to Gary. You know, the English feel, the Scots have got a good measure of devolution. I'm Welsh. The Welsh are getting more devolution. Northern Ireland is having devolution. And the English feel maybe we should have our own parliament because we really want a forum to discuss English things. And that, again, is something, if we look at the unsettled future, something to be fed into it. Gary.
Yeah. So I won't make a political point because I'm not allowed to, but on the, I suppose one of the questions around the uncertainty is who would lead the negotiations for the Leave side? If you think about a two-year timeline, how quickly that you would need to appoint someone, bring the country together behind that. So there's a real challenge in that. And the point about not ending on the 23rd is right as well. The Scottish experience essentially was the day after the referendum, Prime Minister Cameron announced the Smith Commission, which was constituted to look at further powers for the Scottish Parliament. They've now passed into legislation, and the current Scottish Parliament now controls around 65% of all public expenditure in Scotland and around 35% of all revenues. So you can see the balance of powers.
The gentleman who stood up, that's right, and then I said, no, you're number two, not number one.
Thank you. My name is Sigurd Rothe. I'm a student from Germany. To me, this coming from Germany, this talk about like Brexit, it seems so strange for a German even just to consider that option. So I follow the point that Britain has always somehow been detached. It wasn't one of the founding members of the EU, so I get all that. But do you think it was necessary, or was it good that David Cameron took this public discourse to a referendum? Or would it have been better to let it rumble on? And because we now might have like open Pandora's box and there will be other countries wanting to follow if it's successful. So do you think this was wise looking at all of the, like of at Europe's fate? So at not just maybe Britain's fate.
I think most politicians would say you should only hold a referendum if one of three conditions is met. The first is that it doesn't matter. As in the Dutch and the Ukraine free trade agreement. The second is that you can reverse it. The Irish do this, get the wrong result, have another one, keep going. And the third is that you can determine the result, as in North Korea. This is one of the few referenda where none of those conditions are met. My guess, and Brian may have a view, is that the last person who wanted this referendum was David Cameron. You know, it wasn't him saying, hey, I want a referendum, chaps. He was under huge pressure from UKIP taking votes and from within his own party. And his hope was by making his Bloomberg speech a few years ago of committing to an in-out referendum, that would give him 4 or 5 years when he could get on and do what he wanted to do without the distraction of this issue. Now, two things went wrong. First of all, it didn't work. Actually, it intensified the pressure on him. And secondly, perhaps there was an expectation of never mind after the general election, which if we've lost it anyway, it doesn't matter. And if we've won it, the Liberal Democrats will stop us doing it. But sadly, they were too successful and got rid of the Liberal Democrats. So he had to do it. So I don't think he wanted to do it. He understood full well the risks, but he had almost no choice but to do it. For the reasons I've said.
I mean, just a general point, a referendum's usually arise through a democratic mandate. In the Scottish case, as I think the case in the UK, it was part of the manifesto of the government. Mm-hmm. They were elected, so it's about delivering the manifesto. So there's a kind of principle of democracy there.
Can I say I very much agree with that? I very much agree with what Mark said. I would say that David Cameron's problem was that in the 2010 election, there were so many new Conservative MPs who came in who were very skeptical of the European Union for the kind of reasons I gave earlier, that in a way he had a problem managing the party. And if you'd have said, was it a wise thing to do? Not really. I mean, he wouldn't ideally have chosen to do it, but I think he had to. I would only, as you said in introducing yourself, you were from Germany. I'm very impressed, I have to say, by the vision which the founders of the European Union, who are primarily Roman Catholic, and I'm not a Roman Catholic, had at the end of the Second World War in coming together. And there was, I think, and you see it in the concept of the common good, you see it in the social market economy, which was developed by German politicians and academics, economists, and so on. There was a real vision there. And I was amazed, I haven't got it in front of me, but about 10, 12, 14 years ago, Jacques Delors said something along the following lines. If Europe does not realize the original vision which it had, which was about much more than economics, and which was it was about being nations which believed in a common good, unless, he said, we can recapture that, the future of Europe is finished. And I think, therefore, that one thing I see is that I don't think, I mean, the European Union has become so much a matter of economics and of numbers and so on, and the whole sort of spiritual vision of what Europe is about has been left really to decline. And I think that's something very significant. And to me, if when we're advising people in Brussels, it would be, what do you have to do to recreate that original vision which really inspired people and said there really is something here? I'm going to have a young woman. My wife says I must never say young lady. It's very politically incorrect.
Hello, my name is Solveiga. I am from Lithuania and I run my clean tech startup company in the UK. So we've been lucky enough to manage to get some EU funding already. And I just wanted to ask about, or rather, could you speculate what would happen should we leave the EU about innovations in the UK with regards to receiving funding, because the channels of funding are going to be dramatically cut because we'll, I assume, no longer have access to EU funding.
That seems to me to be a question like having advice on the cheap, but in running the business.
I have to say, I think that's a bit of a non-argument, EU funding. The fact is Britain is a net contributor to the budget, not by nearly as much as the Leave campaign would argue. They look at the gross figure, not the net. But it's a net contributor, and if we were not in the EU, we would therefore have some money that doesn't go to the EU, and that money can be used for what the EU is currently spending it on. The argument to me about technology industry is a much wider one, and we have a fantastic technology industry in Britain, which we in the city help to support. And I'm always struck by a huge event we had, bigger than this in the Guildhall, of tech people setting up really great businesses around London. And the Brian Griffith equivalent chairing it began by saying, how many of you not born in London? 75%. How many of you not born in Britain? 50%. These were the leaders of the industry. Mm. And that is what we would miss by not being in the European Union. It is the talent from around the whole of the European Union, which has made London the fintech and the tech capital of the world. And that's what I'm bothered about, not a transfer of money from Brussels.
I mean, the view from Glasgow.
Yep. So I think what would happen the next day? Probably not much. Article 50 of the treaty states it's a 2-year negotiation period. So all EU legislation would continue to be in place, all rights and stuff. So there is a kind of transition period. And I think Mark set out the arguments. The average net contribution for the UK between 2010 and 2014 was £7 billion per year. And some of the benefits of the EU spending throughout the UK, perhaps less so in London, but in the remote rural areas, some of the work they do around protecting natural capital, resources, fisheries policies, all have a big impact in Scotland.
I must ask someone from this side, because you're behind me. A gentleman there. Then.
Thank you. Johannes Kopp from Austria. Not a question to Lord Griffiths, but the lawyer of the Brexit people in charge for that. What have you done to improve the imperfect Europe over the last years?
Can I say, it's a very good question. Can I say, I think, you know, if I'm speaking now personally, I come from a background when Mrs. Thatcher, which was a background compared to the British disease of the 1970s, it was a background of enterprise, of competition, of being open and so on. And I think that we have collaborated with Europe, but I think that Europe has always seemed such a sort of monolithic structure that to get something done, it's so much easier to do it through the British Parliament, because when we go to Europe, we're one of 28. Whereas in the British Parliament, in the House of Commons, if a party is in government and has a majority, it can get things through. So I think it really has to be seen against that background. And then on, for example, things like, which is not my field, but the European Court of Justice, human rights and things like that. The whole issue of deporting terrorists and how Brussels or the court would respond to that. These are the things which I think have worn down some of our politicians. I think you ask a very good question, and I don't think there's been any. Well, maybe Tony Blair was, but there's been no British leader who really had the vision and the energy to really devote themselves. It's the energy almost that you need, because you are dealing in Brussels with a very large, powerful entity. But I don't know what my colleagues would think.
But, I mean, first of all, I agree entirely with you. I think Britain has for too long been shouting from the sidelines. I used to run British trade bodies working in Europe. When I was doing it, we were helping to write the policies, not whinging about them when they'd been written. And, you know, we haven't done enough. We're weak in the Commission. Only 3% of Commission staff are Brits. Our market share should be 8 or 9%. That's not Europe's fault, it's ours. We're weak in the European Parliament. We're weak at government level. We haven't done the sort of relationship building we should have done. When I was deputy chairman of this powerful committee I'm now chairman of, I went to Malta, and they put on a fantastic program for me. And I said, well, I'm not important. They said, you are the most important Briton to have been here for 4 years. The next month, the Europe minister finally turned up. Even worse, he said, no Briton of any importance has been here for 4 years. But I'm hearing that across the board. And what I hear from people in Europe is, we want you to be involved. We like your views. Please take more of a leadership role. Europe has improved in the last 2 years, thanks to Jean-Claude Juncker, who managed to go in a period of about 6 months from totally unheard of in Britain to public enemy number one. To a national treasure, because what he's done to the Commission is great. Mm. We now have a Commission that's functioning as a corporate body, not putting out rubbish. Mm. Drastically reduced the number of new regulations. We have a great British Commissioner, in the right job, doing a brilliant job. So we must do more, but it has got better over the last 2 years.
Yeah. I mean, there is a question of governance over 28 member states, so and the extent to which it's expanded and expanded so quickly, which is a challenge for any organisation of that size, given they're representing 500 million people. From a Scottish perspective, again, we would say that there's many imperfections, but the greater good. If you take a small country perspective, then 9 of the 28 members are a population less than 5 million, so it can give a lot of influence to smaller countries. The wider social, cultural, economic benefits, if you engage, are there to be seen. Again, from a Scottish perspective, we have a lot of renewable energy, a lot of EU-funded programmes, Tidal, Wave, and it can kind of force better collaboration, which is essentially a good thing.
We have time for one last question. I'm going to ask, if I may, a woman to ask it, just to get some balance in terms of gender. Is it possible to have a microphone here? Yeah.
Thank you. What would happen to the city of London?
What's your name?
Michaela Troyanov from Geneva, Switzerland. What would happen with the city of London if the Brexit goes with a yes result? Several large players, large UK banks with international, you know, activities have already said that they would move their seat to continental Europe. Where would they go? What would be the implication?
This is my backyard, so I'm going to ask my two colleagues to answer it, and then I'll do a few sentences and we'll close.
I think we're tempted to merge with Scotland and join the European Union. However, I mean, London is a huge international financial centre and it will remain one. You know, we're in no doubt about that. No business I've talked to says we're going to shut up shop and leave. They don't want to. What they'd have to consider is what are we not now able to do because Britain will not be in the single market and we will not be able to bring in people from other European countries as we currently do. And that will mean when they're taking location decisions anyway, which they do all of the time, that has to be weighed into it. And over time, instead of having, say, 90% of investment banking staff, that number would go down. We would do everything we could to minimize that. What we would be pressing the government for is actually remaining in the single market and preserving the movement of people. And the more that we could do that, the less the impact would be on the city. The uncertainty in itself is damaging. Brian has an involvement with Goldman Sachs. They're building a big new head office in the city. These are 5-year projects, if not more. And the uncertainty needs to be resolved. So it would be unhelpful to the city. It would not be a disaster. And we would do everything that we could to try to preserve not just the jobs in London, but the jobs in the rest of the country that depend on the jobs in London, in the city of London. That is not going to be easy when the commitment is almost to be out of the single market and to do something about immigration.
Yeah. Gary.
Very briefly, it comes to the transition, how you deal with that the day after, the uncertainty, a lot of the attributes of London in terms of the skills, expertise, agglomeration of financial activity would still be in London. So it's about how you manage the transition.
Can I say, I'm sure there are many more questions which people could ask. I think what's come out is that this is a very serious issue. And whatever the outcome, there's a great deal of uncertainty ahead. My own personal feeling is that 28 countries in a political union need a lot of subtlety and flexibility to really work. You can see why the six, or why the countries at present around Germany, where you're crossing the borders all the time, you can see that's a natural area for a larger political entity. But I think my only plea as a personal plea, because I would hate to see Europe in the end really suffer if there was something like Brexit. But my only plea is that there has to be more imagination at the heart of Europe and at discussions in Brussels, and that there has to be, for that debate, a greater depth which goes back to the roots of the European Union itself. And I think it's in rediscovering its roots that Europe will really flourish. And I think probably that's something that all of us can agree on. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.